Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Juma Game Reserve this afternoon. Fantastically warm February afternoon. End of summer, I think it is. We start. Trying to get some cool evenings. I don't think it's really here for real. We might still get some real summer stuff in March. We're at the site of a wildebeest kill at a pride of lion here last night with two big males that came to join them. They killed a wildebeest over here. It was a wildebeest that was quite well known to us. And I have to say, she was only really well known to us because of a particular feature, but I'll get back to that. My name is Mark. Andrew is on camera with me this afternoon, and Brian is back in final control. And hopefully in the next 3 hours, we're going to be doing a good few different adventures. Starting with just looking around here to see if we can see that male and female lion. We had them here in the morning, which meant that the shade was on the western side of bushes, but now in late afternoon it's the opposite side, so the cats would have had to move. We didn't get to see them too well this morning. Off towards the end of the drive, they must have moved into some shade. They can't be very far. I'd just like to maybe just try and find them quickly. It is a pretty hot afternoon, so there's not going to be much happening, and there are a few things to talk about. But there is also the other issue of the pack of wild dogs that are somewhere on this property, and we need to try and find them. So hopefully we can. We're also going to stop by a bunch of sleeping cats just to see how their position has changed with the change in the angle of the sun and where they're going to be. They're probably going to be in a lot deeper shade, because where they were this morning is going to be sort of full sun right now. So it's not easy to always have plans, and plans are always thwarted by all sorts of other things, but I'm hoping that we can somehow stick to a little bit of a plan. It's not often that we have a plan, but because we have so many things active on Juma at the moment, it would be nice to try and follow up and find them. So let's stop the chatting and let's go see what we can find, we can do about it. Start down here a little bit. They weren't far away from here. Problem is, if the grasses are long and these cats in this heat are likely to be flat on their sides, there have been no more vultures here. Clearly, there's been a lot of vulture activity. The bones have been licked clean and they're already starting to bleach and dry out. And I have no doubt that the hyenas are going to come sniffing around, and they're going to still find something to chew on. There's no doubt about that. But I suppose it's almost a pointless exercise trying to figure out where these two mating cats could have found themselves. Can't be too far away. They don't normally go too far. It might be somewhere deeper in this thick bush on the western edge of quarantine. Sorry, Brian, my ear was off if you were saying anything. That's a hot one today. Picture but sound, so all you can do is hear me. Well, at the moment we're not missing much. We haven't seen anything yet. We're just driving. We're going to be driving back towards Juma Waterhole, Gowrie Dam rather, whatever you want to call it. Let's see. The other thing is, being a hot afternoon, it'd be nice to see if there are any pachyderms in the water. No doubt butterflies too, yes. No doubt, buffalo, and with a little bit of luck, an elephant or two having a swim. Only thing we can do is come back here in the evening and see if we can find them in the evening, but I think it's going to be really difficult trying to figure out where they are. Or where they've moved to. They might have even moved closer to the rest of the pride down near Garry Dam. Now there was a buffalo that had been wallowing at the dam. I'm sure that there might have been others that joined him. And pride of lion are not too far from that. Now, the wildebeest that they killed last night, although it is a fairly large mammal, wouldn't have gone very far. It would have satisfied one feeding for most, or each of those individuals, especially the cub. Some of them look pretty full. Obviously, in a situation like that, where you have a large group of lion, we had, I don't know, it didn't look like the males might have fed on that bull. It looks like they might have arrived afterwards, because they're not as full as the females, and I don't think they would have really tolerated the females and cubs feeding on a carcass if they were hungry. You never know, they might have been held at bay. But my impression of what might have, or rather my idea of what might have happened, that's interesting, something I need to show you. The one thing that I think might have happened is that they killed it, they fed as quick as they could, and the larger cats in the pride were the ones that got the most meat. Disregard for the cubs and their well-being, the most important thing is to get the lionesses fed. They're the ones that have to hunt again. And that was probably a single sitting kind of meal, maybe two sittings. And they could very well go into a hunt mode again tonight. There was a buffalo sleeping at the dam, there's probably going to be more. But what is interesting is this wildebeest, this lone wildebeest. I don't know where the rest of the herd are. On a hot day like this, they're in thicker vegetation, they're not too concerned with predators moving around, so they're actually hidden. And ordinarily you would have, especially after an incident last night, perhaps it's because of an incident last night where they lost one, you would expect them to be a little bit more on edge and in a tighter-knit group. However, there's this one. When we first came out here this afternoon, just before we went live, Andrew and I saw her, and she was a lot closer to the kill site where the kill had taken place. She was facing that direction and snorting. I think it's a female. Let's just check. Is it the big bull? It's one of the cows, I think. Still facing the direction of the kill site. But she was running in that direction, turning around and moving back. Now, if any of you remember, when the wildebeest that was killed, this wildebeest that we got to know because she was a very distinct individual with that broken horn, and it was easy enough to bond with her because, well, she was the second one to give birth live. We got to know her calf, and then, gosh, what would happen is the one calf that gets killed by lion with her calf. And then the day after she lost her calf to, I think, the same lion, if I'm not mistaken, the same day she was doing what this wildebeest is doing. Very stressed, running backwards and forwards, looking for her calf. And I'm starting to wonder, you know, there are strong enough bonds within the female group of wildebeest, because they are all, I mean, it's a little mini matriarchal society in its own right. But there must have been a very strong bond between this wildebeest and the one that the lion took last night, because she's clearly looking for that lost soul. Oh, sorry, I'm just babbling on as though you... can all hear me, or rather see what I'm talking about, but you can hear me. We're looking at a particular wildebeest in the distance. I'm hoping that picture can be restored any minute. We've got the relevant technicians busy with it, but it's beyond our shores, I think, that this problem exists. Certainly beyond Juma, because we're broadcasting everything fine from here. Alex or Pete available.
Now restart it again.
Then settings have been changed.
Do you reckon this wildebeest is mourning?
No, I don't know if we could call it mourning. I think mourning is part of it. I think it's a...
Bewilderment?
No, I don't think bewilderment. I think there's a certain understanding of what happened. I've seen giraffes lose their babies that do the same thing. I've seen... where, in fact, Karula did the same thing even when she lost her cub. Is that there is that sense of, there is the mourning and the sense of loss, but there's always that sense of hope that it's, that something happened and it's still there. It's, there's also that, I'm sure there's that energy that they feel is not there anymore, but they still got to look, because for so long, maybe it doesn't have to be that long as in the case of a cub, because the maternal bond is so strong. But it might well be that they, for however long they've had that bond, that relationship, which leads me to believe this might be an old female, and that might even be her daughter.
Yeah.
Or for whatever reason it is, this wildebeest is showing signs of emotional loss by its behavior. Whether we put mourning and sadness and all those other emotional tags to it, doesn't really, the fact is that it is behaving in a manner that shows that it is aware of the loss of another herd member, and it, and that little, I don't know, hope that it's
Hey, Andrew. Not that I know of. I've only checked on the carcass, I haven't checked on Angala. I don't know where that Madura and Mafazi went. One good thing is that I've got a radio that's working now, even though it might kick out the signal when we're driving. But I can at least say a sentence. That was because I swapped. And then I suppose it wouldn't help for us to reboot. I suppose it makes no difference.
What do you think? Just
testing settings.
Yeah.
I'm not really going to drive anywhere right now. I'm welcome to. Questions. I mean, since we are only really talking at the moment, since we don't have visual, chat and if any questions are coming through, we can talk about things while we're waiting for something to happen on the other side of the planet that gives us a better band rate, bandwidth, baud rate, bandwidth, whatever it's called. No questions. It's just maybe Andrew should take off the lens cap comments. Okay, we are broadcasting very well from the vehicle. We have a full signal going from the vehicle to final control. Brian is broadcasting the picture from final control. Somehow what is only coming through to you is the sound and not the picture, which means that the bandwidth, so there is a bandwidth issue, I guess, which means that the bandwidth that is available is enough for audio but not enough for video. That's what it is. I guess. Sound feasible?
Yeah.
A wildebeest better than... Hello, Chris. A wildebeest bigger than Carla... Nyala and Kudu. Carla and Nudu. Nyala and Kudu. Much bigger than Nyala. Bigger than Kudu. Well, there's a difficult one. Probably about the same, I'd say. Although Kudu can probably be a little bigger.
see. No, I've got to. I've got to look at weights and measures again. Chris, good question. Thanks for the question. In relationship to kudu, kudu will stand taller, but you see, I think kudu are likely to be a little bit slimmer or not. Slimmer, yeah, maybe slimmer. Wildebeest might stand shorter, but they're a little bit bulkier around the shoulders and things, maybe. I know they've got a... I'll tell you in a sec. Let's get there. Weights and measures. Yeah, I know, I'm supposed to know all these things. I've been a guide for 30 years. But... I need to do more crossword puzzles and Rubik's Cubes. My memory is not so good as it was in the old days. Where's a wildebeestie? There's a wildebeestie. Wait, wait. Hello, Marjo in the Nelligen. I'm tongue-tied this afternoon. Hello, Marjo in the Netherlands. Nice to hear from you. And yes, I do owe you an email. You're quite right. If it's the same Marjo that I'm thinking of, was the wildebeest killed by the Nkuhumas? And is it true that one of them was killed? Yes, it is. It's kind of a karma thing today for the for life on Earth. A lion was killed and a wildebeest died. Or rather, both were killed. Greater kudu, up to 300 kilograms for males. And a wildebeest, up to 290 kilograms. For males. So I guess you could say overall kudu are bigger. I would have thought that maybe wildebeest might have been a bit heavier, even though they're not as tall, because kudu kudu stands about 1.4 meters at the shoulder. 1.5, basically about 1.5 meters at the shoulder. And wildebeest, well, I suppose also 1.5, 1.4 as well. Kudu up to 300 kgs. And what's the next possibility? We're going to have to leave this wildebeest. I want to go down to the dam. It's hot. Okay, well, we're just going to have to drive, and I'll have to try and describe things to you as we drive. Okay. Unfortunately, this is our drive this afternoon. You know, you get those restaurants where there are visually impaired people that serve you, and the entire restaurant is in the dark, and you have to order and do everything in the dark because you have to experience life. You have to experience life as people who don't have the gift of vision. So, this is the safari. We are driving down towards Juma Waterhole Gowrie Dam. I've got to make my hair and makeup, and I've got to look neat for Juma live drive radio show. And I hope that at some point this afternoon we're going to have some luck receiving a good enough bandwidth and a good enough signal to send video. A little disappointing, I understand, but we are possibly dealing with forces beyond our control. Something might be happening in the world right now that we don't know of that's affecting things. The buffalo that we saw at Juma Waterhole or Gowrie Dam this morning is still there. He is lying in the water as the buffalo on his own. No other buffalo have joined him. A bright sunny day this afternoon, blue sky. One or two tiny little clouds on the horizon, but other than that, and a slight breeze that is coming in from a rather strange angle. We've got a slight breeze coming in from the northeast. Might have something to do with the weather change. We're lucky. I hope we're lucky to be able to have a weather change. And we are on Twin Dams Road now, making my way into this Gowrie thicket where we saw the pride of lion this morning. And I'm hoping that they're still fast asleep amongst this Gowrie bush thicket. I think that's, they'll no doubt have moved. Might be a better option to get down below. Who's on the right? There's a cat. Probably got so hot. Thank you, Ryan. Oh, I went into the other. That's wonderful. That means we can go and sit there and wait for a picture to come back, and I can try and narrate what it's like to sit next to a pride of lion. See how good my skills are. Things like that. Kerry, good afternoon to you, Kerry. And great to have you on drive with us from a place like Secunda. And I suppose we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. There's the big male. 5, 6, 7, 8. Almost the entire pride. We are not down in that little Gowrie thicket that we were in this morning. They've crossed the road into the open. They're all lying in the shade of a beautiful big wattle tree. And they're all panting. Some asleep, some lifting their heads. I'm going to get myself into a position and hope that we're going to get a picture back at some point. It is the most beautiful sight to see, and it's classic.
Must have been that radio, and I was switched off.
Thank you, London.
Thank you, Moscow. And thank you, Alex. And thank you, Brian. Between everybody, they managed to get us a picture back again. And just to show you that I wasn't joking when I said they're sitting in the shade of a very big wattle and a few broken branches from an alley in the lovely grassland. The entire pride with one of the Matimbas. What I didn't tell you is that half of them have now crashed, because they're just cats. They've got to sleep. This one little round patch of shade has an entire pride of lion, and you wouldn't believe it if you were just strolling by. Although they'd probably get up pretty quickly and you'd probably get the shock of your life. Which is why you don't stroll by. Now comes the tricky part. We're going to go and look for the dogs. We said we would. We've seen them. We're going to come back to them. They're going to get a little bit more active as it cools down. Their shade is only going to get better, I think. There's the shade of a big marula tree behind this wattle that's going to add to it, and maybe they'll still be here. But I think I want to go and find out what might have happened to these wild dogs. So we're going to have to do quite a little bit of a loop. Quite a little bit of a... round trip to see where we can maybe pick up tracks. And I also want to look at some dams in case there's an elephant or two. So we'll start by maybe going up to Biffleswick Dam. Or not. It's quite clear that that big male wasn't here for the kill, because he's got quite a thin tummy. There he is. I think he might have arrived later and maybe only got a few scraps.
her face here and this one's face there. Please. Oh, I like that. Okay, I think let's move along. And we'll come back later.
Okay. Questions too. While we're moving along. Kim in Chicago. Kim's asking if impala are akin to white-tailed deer. No. I don't think in any way can they be compared.
Leaving Ngala Lalapan's in the open on the western side of Twin Dams. To south of the dam on the western side of Twin Dams Road, they're in the open. No, I had a look for them, but I couldn't find them. They're somewhere, they must still be there. Bye, children.
My eldest lifts his head and takes it.
Goodbye. See, now, I want to, now that you're looking, I just want to duck.
Zoom in on your eye type of thing.
Sorry, okay, I'll let you go to sleep now. You don't have to eat Andrew today. You had enough
Brian's mom. Can't have Brian's friend. But I intimidated him by talking to him. Active a little bit earlier than I anticipate. It might even be before sunset. So I'm going to take a trip right to Bifflebrook Dam, and then we're going to try and see if we can find some tracks from those dogs around, maybe some of the yellies, and come back to the can as we can, because it's going to be our best bet.
Hi, I'm John. Hi.
Very good, isn't it?
Good.
Hello.
Hi. They're just there with it. There's that worry under that wattle.
Nice. Beautiful sighting.
I'm going to go find some corns for those mothers. Yeah, I've got buffles of them come around.
I couldn't find anything this morning.
Cool.
Bye.
Bye.
Yes,
bye.
Beast because of the horn.
No, I.
Signal. Yeah, it's Washington. Wanting to know if they could have picked out that wildebeest because of the horn.
No, it wouldn't have gone down like that.
It was a nighttime hunt. They would have chosen the individual they saw was the most vulnerable. From other words, it was the one individual that was separated from the herd for that little moment that they needed to hunt. I don't think it had anything to do with the horn. I don't think she was singled out. I don't think it had anything to do with her ability to defend herself. It was just a really unfortunate thing that she was the one that might have been 6 feet away from the herd, or just a little bit slower, or I can see a Malachi kingfisher. And we have to creep up on this kingfisher. So I see there's a buffalo. Now, Andrew, in those trees ahead of us, let's see, there is, let me try and guide you. Okay, now there's a, try and do it like this. Oh, my finger's too big. There's that nest over there. I don't want to go to that nest. I want to go down to about here somewhere. And where that is, oh wait, yeah, you got it. Yeah, that was it. It was diving. Because I saw it flying and I saw it land. And it just landed on the bush. I can see it's back there on that branch. It just dived into the water. That's the most magnificent little kingfisher you've ever seen. Gone deeper into this bush though. Might dive back again. It's gone really deep in. But I'm hoping. Of course, it could have been a pygmy at that distance. I thought malachite, because malachites live on water and pygmy don't. But pygmy still need to drink and bathe. Sorry. Another time, perhaps. There was still a question, Brian, and I know it's a while ago, but it was from Secunda, and I forgot what the question was. Something about elephant, I think. Or retweet it, maybe. Oh, that's like ring barking, certain trees. That means I've forgotten this last question. But yeah, the question was about elephants only ring barking certain trees and why. Trying to understand what an animal does and or interpret it from a human perspective is a very difficult thing, because we put far too much into things that might be relatively simple. Or we might see them as simple acts of destruction, or we might see them as simple things, but they might even be far more complicated. Which one this is, and I would imagine that in some cases, some trees are ring barked for reasons of one, and some might be ring barked for simple reasons, and some might be ring barked for more complicated reasons. Here's a big knobhorn, giant knobhorn, ring barked one day.
probably the other two to the left. Maybe elephants just didn't want them to grow there anymore, or they wanted those trees to feed the soil. They were too tall, they were too high, they were too old. They needed to have those trees recycled so that new trees can grow, because in the time that those trees have been growing, they've kind of denuded the soil. They've taken a lot of nutrients out of the soil. They prevented other trees from growing at their base, because trees do that. Some trees have this mechanism whereby they can release things into the soil, enzymes and things. Don't get too complicated. Keep it simple. Stupid. That prohibit the germination of other trees because that limits the amount of competition, water and resources underneath the crown of a tree. And so sometimes elephants need trees to die. Look, baboons, primates. We're going to have to stop here, because if we try and get closer they might run, because they might be quite shy. So for now we're just going to have a little bit of a distant view of a troop of baboons. I don't know where they come from. They're certainly not the old Gowri crowd. But the Gowri gang. But we might be able to get a little bit closer. There's an eagle. A brown snake eagle in a tree to our right, by the looks of things. Very clearly a snake eagle. You can see that the legs are very bare. They don't have feathers all the way down to the feet. That's one of the major differences between snake eagles and the true eagles. But from our eagle, baboon obviously not too concerned with it. There are a few youngsters climbing some dead trees up ahead. Also nice to get a brown snake eagle like that, because often they fly away very quickly. But there are some baboon sitting on some tree stumps up ahead. Whether it's because of our presence, I think they would probably ignore a brown snake eagle. I think that we can credit them with enough intelligence to know which eagles are dangerous and which eagles aren't. And there, some of them are starting to react to our presence. But we're just going to get a little bit closer and see if we can observe them for a while. It's a long time since we've been able to watch some primates. And I know we're supposed to be looking for wild dog, but sometimes in the process of watching other things, you find the things you've been looking for. Fellow primates. Can you see those on the tree stumps? We need to get a bit closer, perhaps. If they'll allow us, maybe by doing it slowly we can edge our way closer. Interesting, there's some yep. Okay, now I'm sorry to drag you. No, gonna lose her now. She's gonna go past there too. The female with a baby riding jockey style on her back. Okay, let's creep closer and see if they let us get a bit closer. Starting to move off. Eating the seed heads of grasses, and that was an asparagus that he pulled down.
I think.
No, it wasn't.
Grass. Sneak a bit closer. I would like to have some of these youngsters that are on the dead tree allow us to get a bit closer so we can watch some of their antics, because they might get quite comical. I guess there's a lot of ticks, a lot of fleas. Part of life is scratching. Suddenly the whole troop's moving off. Okay, here we go. There's a little one of this dead tree is gonna come and tease us. I hope. Here we go. They'll hide and they'll try all sorts of things to intimidate us. They're just playing. Happens more on foot, where they'll shake trees and they'll try and show strength. The idea is not to be intimidated, despite their strength. Baboon having probably the longest canines of any meat-eating animal here in the bush. They are formidable killers if they need to be, or when they want to be, rather. That was quite a troop. Still here. So it must be quite a large troop if they're quite well spread out. I'm
guessing it's the same troop of baboon that visited Gowrie Dam, the Tumor Waterhole, a few weeks ago. Remember there was a troop that came in and they spent about 2 days. They came in during the day one day. I think they overnighted somewhere close to Gowrie Dam and then disappeared. I think that possibly they're a troop from one of the neighboring dam at Chitwa Chitwa, at the lodge at Chitwa Chitwa. It appeared that that's where they came from when I found the tracks. I've seen them down Gowrie Main towards this. A scouting mission, being a large group, needs to be different different. Yes. Okay. Biffles of cut line, we're heading up towards Biffles Dam. We're gonna have to try and find out if we can find some sign of these canids that have been running around. I believe a pack of about 14 of them that might have been here. And while we missed them this morning, we took a long drive looking for them. My thoughts were that they'd gone to ground where they lay down somewhere and went in the shade and been passing their time during the heat of the day. The closest dam to where they were, I think when they were last seen, is Biffles Dam, so I'm taking a chance. There were also some elephants just off a cheetah cut line east of Biffles Dam, so I'm hoping that maybe by coming to the dam, maybe we'll just sit there for a little bit, see what there might be. Up some sounds maybe from somewhere along the line, somewhere. Gail wants to know what the baboons eat besides grass, since we were with those baboons. Gail, they have an incredibly wide and varied diet. Baboons are very much omnivorous primates. They, as far as vegetation is concerned, they will eat grasses, whether it's the seed heads, the flower heads, or even the blades of grass. Sometimes I'll just pick small blades of grass to eat. They do eat, though, they eat any other plants that are edible, or other plants that are edible. There's been elephant here, and he's left already, judging by those tracks. That is still enough. Other plants, they will either eat the stems or the roots. They'll dig up tubers, they'll dig up bulbs, they'll dig up potato-like things. They will catch insects. They know how to catch scorpions. They will kill anything small. They can even kill and sometimes eat young impala, young warthog. When they get a little bit of a hankering for protein, they become quite carnivorous. They will find berries and fruits. You can almost imagine that they would, if we were to have to try and survive in this environment, I would say that whatever baboons are eating would be a fair start to what we would need to feed on to survive, probably because they're one of the closest primates to us. Of course, there are things that their stomachs can tolerate that ours can't, and the things that are less palatable to us that would be still acceptable to them. But an incredibly wide and varied diet for the Chacma baboon. Sadly, no elephant. Golly gosh. Just hoping to see one frolicking here in the water on a hot summer's day. Good afternoon, Chantal. Mandrill baboons. Do we get mandrills or are these mandrills? Chantal in Canada wants to know about mandrills and our baboons. Our baboons are called Chacma baboons. Mandrills only occur in Central and West Africa. Let me show you a picture of a mandrill. Or even, no, sorry, East. I think highlands of Ethiopia. And then you also get the, there's the mandrill male. Look at that, they very different. They have a very short stubby tail. No, I'm right. It is, well, there's sort of, it's mostly West Africa, not in East Africa. It's the Galadas, the Galada baboons in East Africa that I was thinking of. That's the male mandrill. An exceptionally colorful baboon, but you have to, you'd have to see his face, and I encourage you to try and do it. There we go, there's the grimace of a big male mandrill. You also get another monkey, or rather another primate called a drill, not a mandrill, but there's the drill, which is a little bit different, not as colorful. As you can see, this is, there's this other picture here, is the difference between the mandrill and the drill, the two big males. Where a mandrill does a grimace, the drill does a head tilt and juts his chin out as a dominance thing. But these are primates from West Africa, certain very, very specific areas of West Africa. In Oregon, to use an analogy, not Oregon, Washington, what am I saying, the Olympic rainforest in Washington, higher than Oregon. Okay, on we go with our quest. I'm starting to think that these dogs might have just lay down somewhere and that we'll find all their tracks tomorrow, and maybe it's a little bit of luck. Tomorrow will be stage 3 of the great wild dog escapade. Another eagle just flew. Oh, he landed. Good. Maybe we can get an ID. Another snake eagle. Looks like maybe another brown. Yep. Another brown snake eagle. Different one because it's a little bit darker. Okay, let's try and sneak closer if we can. Brown snake eagles are notoriously shy.
point where you can get to before they become intimidated. And part of it is actually trying to pretend you're not watching them. Part of it is trying to identify that moment when you're close enough, but you need to stop.
Squirrels are shouting for something else, for some other reason. Okay, let us move along. There seems to be a lot of squirrel alarming going on around here. I can't believe that it's for a brown snake eagle, because generally they're not really concerned with brown snake eagles. Down there and see why squirrels are shouting so intently. Or intensely. Both intensely and intently. That might have something to do with this eagle who's just flown off. Gene. Also sitting close by. Can I land? No, flying on. Oh, there's another raptor here too. Rather strange. Now this is a true eagle. This could be a Wahlberg's, but I think it might be something else. Very yellow sear. A bit big for a Wahlberg's, but I have to be honest, it's a little bit dark in there underneath this torchwood. But really strange that a gymnogene flew out of there, and that
which could be maybe a tawny, or it's actually a little bit small for a tawny. Beak's too big for a Wahlberg's. Could it be a lesser spotted or something? Didn't see any white. I'm gonna see now if it flies, or if it hopefully stays there, we can get a better look at it from down here, although it's gonna be a really strange angle to look at this bird, especially into the light. There's no way we're gonna be able to, can't even see it now. Oops. Straight into the sun, that's not gonna work. And I didn't notice its wing pattern or anything. There it goes, it's actually flying along the drainage line. Oh boy. I suppose you don't always have to know what they are. It'd be nice to, but... Hello Sandy, is there any time of the year when the animals are more active at Juma? No, not really. I mean, it's 365 days a year. Animals are here. They do every day of the year. They do the same thing pretty much. I think there's seasonal movement, and there are times when there might be more elephant activity, there are times might be more giraffe activity, there might be times when there is more zebra around. But generally, there's no time of the year when... It's not like a very stark difference between your northern hemisphere seasons, with snowy winters and mild summers, and such a stark contrast in terms of what the vegetation and the environment has to offer. So you have a very distinct difference between summertime happiness and wintertime hibernation. I think if I had to live in the northern hemisphere, I'd probably just hibernate for the whole winter, because I just couldn't handle all of that snow and ice and cold. But I don't know how I would do that, because then I'd have to be indoors all the time. I don't know if I could do that either. But here, you know, squirrel, got no road sense or what? Here, our daytime temperatures don't vary very much. I mean, we get very hot days in summer. By the same token, we can get cold, rainy days. We can have days where it's been raining for 2 or 3 days straight. It's been cold and gray, and there's a cold wind blowing, and everything is wet and damp. And it could be even colder than the coldest day in winter. Or we could have these winter days where there isn't a cloud in the sky and you're at almost 30 degrees at noon, because it's just one of those lovely warm winter days, and it can be still 90 degrees Fahrenheit. And it's because of that, the only thing that changes is the vegetation. That changes according to the rainfall, that changes according to the climate and the length of the day and the angle of the sun. And I suppose most importantly, the availability of moisture. So a lot of things become dormant, a lot of the vegetation becomes dormant in the dry season. And so there's a very distinct difference between what the trees and the plants do throughout the year. But animals have to still carry on doing what they do, regardless of what the vegetation is doing. So even if it might be the dry season, all the browsers and grazers still have to find enough vegetation to eat. They still have to browse, they still have to graze. And they know how to find things. They know where to find things. They know what they can eat and what they can do. So not much.
see, if you came across wild dog and they were lying down, they were sleeping, if you came across them while on foot, I suppose Susan is asking so much different options, and ground, what is it? But Susan, it's some wild dog, I suppose most wild dog that I've ever encountered on foot, as soon as they hear the footsteps of a two or a bipedal two-legged beast or a bipedal beast like us, they get up, and if you continue to approach, they would run away. They would give a few alarm calls, alarm barks, and they would run away. There are very few pets of wild dog that can tolerate humans on foot. There is never any danger from wild dog on foot, so one is not likely to be attacked by them. But they are very wary of us as humans. And I've spent a lot of time in many different places, from South Africa to Botswana and Tanzania, being on foot with wild dog, having some of the most wonderful experiences of my life, being with them on foot hunting. I've even been running after them on a hunt effort battle when the ground is soft and there are no thorns or anything. And that's been at home. So the problem with the question is that you're asking me a question that every single pack of wild dogs will do something different, and every day within the lives of those individual packs, they will do something different. There's not going to be a universal set of behavior when the circumstances arise with a sleeping pack of wild dog and a human coming along on foot. But I would say, generally speaking, they are likely to move off. They're likely to be very afraid and to run away. Dinos. Oh, my heart took a leap. I was seeing something on the road way up ahead. And of course, speaking about wild dog, I thought it was wild dog, but it's just a branch hanging over the road that was moving as we were getting closer. So far, I'm not seeing any tracks that cross the road. I'm looking, trying to find tracks. This is Biffles of Cut Line. I want to see if they might have gone north. My best bet is to head west. My biggest problem is I don't really know which direction they went. I was getting some direction from the guys. From where they last saw them in the east, there's no indication of where they might have gone from there. We know that they were moving west, but we don't know whether they intended to become to branch more to the north, which would have put them onto this road, or if they might have headed further south. And the reason why we're not finding any tracks, I think, is because, well, it's quite simple. They've been sleeping under a tree all day. It means they might have been hunting early this morning on their way here. So how far should we go? I know there's some elephants on Weaver's Nest that I would love to get to before we... It's sucking or something. Let me just pick it up. That's dangerous for animals. Must have fallen off a truck.
signal's gonna go funny any minute now. Today must be a day of solar flares and Mercury in retrograde. And oh, you know what? I forgot to tell you, or rather say, I forgot to mention. Happy New Year to all our Chinese viewers too. China. Happy New Year. The year of the gummy. There I was. I was telling you a story about a goat that I saved, and what happens? It turns out to be the year of the goat. What can I say? Today is the new moon and a new year Chinese calendar. That's also Rosh Chodesh, it's the new month. It is also going to see a change in the weather in the next 2 days. Back to Gary Dam, we're going to take him Boogaroo. I don't give up on dogs easily, really I don't. But there are times when you just have to swallow your pride and say, okay, nothing's going to happen, I'm not going to be able to accomplish what I set out to do. And I failed at my task. However, I didn't fail entirely, because I still have tomorrow, and tomorrow can be phase 3 of the wild dog quest, because I don't want to be so far away looking for wild dog that I might be sleeping so far, or they might even be sleeping 10 feet off the road, I might not have seen them, but they've been sleeping, it's been a hot day. And they're possibly going to get active in the next 10 to 15 minutes or half an hour or whatever, because the sun is going down and they're likely to be doing a bit of running and hunting at dusk while it's still light. I'm hoping though that being a really dark night tonight with the new moon, that they're not going to go very far. That tomorrow morning, we've got a new slate. Tomorrow morning the roads are going to be be cleaned, but what I mean is that there are going to be new tracks on the road that are going to be more than just a few hours old, more than just the daytime tracks, because the daytime is an entirely different set of life. It is an entirely different world out there that walks around in the daytime, and then come nightfall we have certain things that cruise and it lets us time stamp tracks, because there are certain things that will walk at night and that they'll put their footprints on top of today's tracks, so that whatever might come out in the morning and start walking in the morning will be on top of the nighttime or the nocturnal creatures. So it's a new day tomorrow, and unless we bump into them when they start moving now, maybe they come past Gowrie Dam or something similar, nobody's been able to find any sign of them this afternoon, because we're not the only ones that have been looking. And so it's time, it's that day, that time of day, that late afternoon sunshine, when we need to get back to where we know some animals are, to get back to their lives, because they're going to be waking up soon. I did hear of some elephant that might be somewhere off of Weaver's Nest, and while it might still be a little bit early to go back to the cats, it's early enough to get back to the same area, because if we can find those ellies and sit with them for a bit, we'll get to the cats at sunset. Far too many plans to go to plan, because the best is not to have any plan. The plan, because you know it's not going to happen. Nature, it's random. It is an entirely unknown entity. that we had advanced into. We're driving down the road, and within the next few seconds, anything is possible that we never thought you could ever witness or see. And I admit that a lot of the time, nothing happens. Hello, Franklin. Sorry. Other than a Franklin running out with you. A lot of the time, there isn't really much because of temperature, which is not catching them at the right place at the right time. But it's, for me, it's the potential. I'm listening to the radio and I want to talk. I switched off for that. Andrew again? Oh, you're lucky. Sorry about that. Sometimes you've got to talk on the radio, and unfortunately, sometimes it has that effect. No sign of the dog. What's interesting is that from this side of the dam, we're coming back to Gary Dam. Oh, and so are the baboons, the whole troop actually. Come to think of it, looks like they're coming to sleep at the dam tonight. They're in for a big surprise of the pride of lion on the other side of this drainage line. This is a big troop of baboons. No, there's Musa Maningi at the dam. Aubrey's coming down Gari Cutline and he's saying there are a lot of baboon. Where we first saw them, he's saying there are a lot of the baboon there. And we're seeing a lot of them here, which means that this troop, that's probably one of the biggest troops I've ever seen. Must be more than 100 strong or something. There's an eagle going down there too. I think that's the Wahlbergs. This is an incredibly large troop of baboon. Big male in the background coming into picture now. Oh, with the bad foot. It sounds like there are a bunch of vehicles that are coming to the line at the moment, because it looks like it's been one of those afternoons, or sounds like it's been one of those afternoons with very little happening. And I guess vehicles are coming in from other lodges to come and see the line, because there's nothing else elsewhere. Guys are talking about a pair of cheetah up on Torchwood, but they're still trying to find them because they were quite skittish and they ran off into the bush. Other than that, there's very little else that's been found this afternoon. So we're going to bypass the line because there are a bunch of vehicles that are there already, and I say, here there are one or two that are coming to the line. And they're probably still going to be sleeping. See, there's a herd of impala here, not very far from the herd. The pride. And I want to just head up towards. Oh, we can actually go in the opposite direction. In fact. We're going to go back over the dam wall. We're going to go back up Central Road. We'll leave these folks to do, or to spend a little bit of time with the lion. I was going to go and look for the elephant that we're on further back. Again, on and off, on and off. Well, this is what we live with. This is the trials and tribulations of bringing you a live picture from the middle of Africa or Southern Africa. Actually, we're not in the middle of Southern Africa. We're up in the northeastern part of South Africa, one of the biggest national parks in Africa and perhaps the world, one of, they are bigger. Area that is relatively untouched in time, only affected by roads and a few man-made water holes. Other than that, it's a wonderful world of wildlife we try and bring you every day. And right now, we're looking for something that big and grey and got big ears and big teeth, big feet, thick skin, and hearts of gold. Minds of wonder. Hello, everybody. Hello. Hello, Anne. Anne's from Oregon. I don't even know if the baboons cause any problems with our masks. They used to. We used to. There used to be, there was in the past, a local troop of baboon. They weren't as big as this troop here, but there was a fair sized troop. They used to live practically at and on our mast all the time, and they did. They caused problems with the mast, they caused problems with the cameras. They did cause a few problems of note. I can smell elephant. That sweet smell you're smelling is an elephant in must. And there's an elephant somewhere close by. Might have gone up that way. Franklin's. I'm gonna try the radio. Excuse me. Aubrey, come in. Well, Orbs, which way was that in Dwarf heading? Smell of elephant, I suppose. There's an elephant. That looks like him. That might be that big bull in the... Oh, he's big. My word. I'll give up wild dog or lion or anything any day for a bull like this. And he's in must because we can smell him. You smelt that, Andrew?
Yeah.
Thing is that there was that. There's another one. Smaller one. He's a lovely big bull. There was a family group. There was a... Ah, there's a baby. There is a family group here. So these boys... couple of bulls here that are courting these girls, so we've got to try and find our little way in here. You know what, we might be late tonight, I'm sorry to say. If somebody could just phone Mom and say, sorry Mom, we're going to be late tonight, or sorry boss, I'm not coming into work today, or the equivalent. But I still want to get back to those lions eventually. And well, everybody's been looking for the dogs. They haven't woken up yet, so they haven't been moving around yet. But we've got a lovely little herd of ellies here. Oh, unfortunately, we've got sunshine in our face. Hello, Mr. Ellie. Lovely little bull here on our left. But I want to get to see that monster. There he is.
that. Oh, he's magnificent. Hello, little boy. Oh, you're on him already. He's come a-courting. Very thick here, so we might just get a glimpse of these giant tusks or just this giant elephant that's going to come in, but we're going to stop here. Oh, there's two. Look at this bull. He's also big. Here's one of the big cows. Now this is this. Let's get things into perspective here. This is one of the large cows. She's fairly big. If we look at how big she is. Hello, madam. Very nice to meet you this afternoon. One of the calves next to her. She's big. Now she's a fairly big Ellie. These two bulls that are here, and not even this bull that's coming up to the car right now. He's only about the size of her, the big bull behind us. But yeah, look at the size of this monster coming out of the bush now. He's just moving past in the background, so he's quite far back, so he doesn't appear that much bigger than her, but he would probably tower maybe 3 or 4 feet above her. Nothing compared to this magnificent boy that's going to be making his appearance any minute now. I don't want to really move. I'm hoping he's going to just come in front of us and say hello and be kind and considerate, because I'm just he's lovely. You just look at those big he's lovely. Patience with a big boy like this. Hello, Mr. Ellie. Hello, big man. This is Big Boss Man.
Yeah.
Hello, Big Boss Man. You ain't big, you're just tall, that's all.
I must be pretty close to a tusker.
He's one of the tuskers. I don't know, you know what?
That's what you did.
We are luckier to see him than we are to see wild dog. That's my opinion about anything. While I've been talking, I missed some stuff about those dogs. Susan, how old is he? He's 40s, at least, in his 40s, resting his trunk on his tusk. I'm going to go forward. Well, watch this with his tusk. With his tusk, we can't really see it. It's behind that little acacia, but he's pushing with his tusk on this little silver cluster leaf. Not quite breaking it. Okay, well, let's just break a branch. Not going to feed on it or anything. Feeding on the grasses underneath it. I don't know whether that's to intimidate me or whether it's to show strength to the other bulls that are here. There's probably a cow that's in estrus, and that's why there are a couple of bulls here. And none of the other bulls are going to have any chance with this monster because, gosh, he's big. He's big. Oh gosh, that's so amazing. I'm not sure who he is. I'm sure I've got photos of him before. I probably have. Got a couple of photos now. I wasn't really concentrating on getting photos. I was just so excited, and of course the monkey wanted to see, so he had to sit on the dash and get his adventure photo taken. I'm in heaven. Look, I'm in heaven. Look at this. Hello, boys. Just be nice to the girls, that's all I can say. Or to each other. I think he's not really in must, but maybe the end stage of must that we're smelling, but we can definitely smell must elephant. Look at this, there's a bit of interaction where he's coming out of the bush and this younger bull is actually turning around and showing submission. This younger bull's got no chance of doing anything in this herd. He can only... There's that lovely smell of elephant must again. At least four big bulls here. Only two really big bulls of any note. Two bulls that are... Little boy didn't like that breaking the branch. I'm sorry. One of them is in full must. It might be this old man. In fact, I think I'm seeing a fifth bull now. Oh, there is. There's even a fifth bull. Yeah, he is in must. He's not in. He's not dribbling much. His inner thigh, the inside of his legs are wet, so he is dribbling a little bit. He's leaking from his temporal gland. I would imagine that maybe he's only just coming into must, maybe, because it doesn't look like it's been that way for a long time, as it would look if he's been in must for some time. But definitely that it's starting. Hello, young man. He's half the age. This little dude, half the age, got a good 3 feet shorter than that big bull. Michigan. Bill's asking if this Ellie is perhaps as big as that bull when I was standing next to the marula tree that time when we saw him eating the mushroom and that scenario. I think this bull's bigger. I think he'd probably stand a little bit taller at the shoulder. In fact, we can probably, since the herd is moving, we can find a spot where there he is, he's letting us. Ooh, very strong scent of Ellie. I think there are actually more bulls here than I thought at first. This little family group seems to be followed by the two behind, at least six bulls.
Mastulele. Some people are saying this is Mastulele, the bull. I don't know. I really don't know. I'm going to only have to look him up. He's not a collared bull. Not many big tuskers who are not collared have names, unless the guides have named them. But Mastulele, he is... I was considering what we would call an emerging tusker here in Kruger. He's certainly got the genes for big tusks. He's not. He's still healthy. I can see his the way he carries his head. There it is. Look at that. He's just wrapping an entire tree around his trunk, and he's probably going to rip it out of the ground or something. Just showing off to these younger boys that are around him. The thing is that these younger boys are probably his askaris, and he's here to court a female, and they're just here because he's here. They know that they've got no option, no chance whatsoever to get involved in this whole situation, especially since he's in must, and all they're really here for are his entourage, young bulls that have joined up with him to learn about being bulls. And hello, little boy. Yeah, this is a teenager. He's not even 20 years old, this one. I'm the head. This is why I do what I do. To just have 5 minutes of this. The length and weight of his tusks, they're about 6 inches and they weigh about 5 pounds. Marisha, Texas. Sorry, I'm not giving off that kind of info. I mean, they're big, but I don't know how to gauge it. Yeah, I mean, they're big tusks. They're probably heavy and all, but I don't want to encourage people to... Look at that, he's polishing the edge of his tusk. Oh, he's holding onto it with his trunk. Length, 5 feet. I don't know about weight. I don't know. They're big. He's big. He's just a magnificent bull. You see, I don't want just to see an elephant and have to think about what the length and the weight of his tusks are, because that implies something to me. That there are... He's just a magnificent elephant bull, and the fact that a human being could even think of doing something to a mammal, to a person like that, because he's a person in an elephant body. I'm just saying that he's got lovely tusks, and I don't want us to sort of measure them the way they would be measured on a commercial market, because that is killing all tens of thousands of elephants in Africa every year. The fact that humans want to know how big and heavy and long the tusks are and how much they're worth and what they can do with them. And all of these religious carvings that are causing the decline of Africa in the name of religion. Hello, Sandy. How long do they have to be before they become known as tuskers? I don't think there's a measurement, Sandy. They become these majestic old bulls that exude wisdom. They just give off this aura of kind of like what Nelson Mandela did when he was up. It's just like this wise old man that just is the right thing for society. Of course. A bunch of palookas now. Never mind, I won't go that far. Based on our last State of Nation address, we're in a real state in this nation. Because they're no longer majestic old men. With years and years of wisdom running the country, they're just greedy old farts. Thank you.
I think it's time we need to leave them, because we're getting into really thick bush here, and I don't want to really trouble them too much, especially since we can only follow them, and it's never really a wise idea to be following them all the time. Elephants don't really like stuff behind them. It would be nice if we could try and get in front of them. And these boys are just really, they're just following this family group, this group of cars. Maybe we can see them from the road. Looks like they're coming out onto the road, actually. We can just squeeze through this little gap over here. Back onto Hyena Road. Yep. Maybe catch up with some of these little ones. There he is. We get a nice view of him actually coming into the open. He's breaking terminalia. I think he's just doing it partly because of being in must, and partly, oh, please stop and look at me. Oh, didn't get a good photo. Anne in Pennsylvania. Hello, Anne. Gosh, I've been asked this question a lot, to try and describe the smell of, the must smell of an elephant. It's sweet, it's sweaty, it's, Andrew helped me, because to describe, it's hard, so hard to describe a smell.
It's like after you've just ridden a horse, and that horsey smell mixes, yeah, sweet, sweety, sweet smell.
Yeah, it's kind of like a sweet, musty, pungent, sweaty,
not a bad smell.
Some people can't handle it, some people get nauseous with it. Sometimes we've got an elephant in full must, it can be very overwhelming. He's not in full must, I think he's only just coming into must. Looking at his, well, he is dribbling quite strongly now, come to think of it, but it's still quite clear. It needs to become greenish and yellowish. And we look at his temporal gland, we can see that it looks like it's fairly new secretions coming out of his temporal gland. It's not, it hasn't been a constant drizzle that has saturated a whole patch of skin on his temporal, on sort of from his temporal gland down to his cheek and his lower jaw. So it leads me to think that maybe he's only just coming into must. It sounds like some of the lion are actually drinking at Gowrie Dam. So I'm thinking that maybe it's time for us to leave these pachyderms, getting really thick in here. And a couple of people are saying, is this the same Ellie we saw eating the giant mushroom, that Ellie that was standing next to the marula tree, and then we managed to get the comparison? I want to go forward, but I'm just going to go right into his rump, and he's going to turn around and get cross with me, so I don't want to do that. I don't know. I don't know. I don't think so. I've got to look at photos. I can't remember that Ellie as much as I would like to. So I think since it's getting really thick and it's getting closer to sunset and all, let's get ourselves back to Gowrie Dam. Has to be the greatest surprise of my day, undoubtedly. I think a bigger surprise and a more wonderful surprise for me personally than if it had been the wild dog that we bumped into. Although I love watching wild dog, I love spending time with them, and I'm lucky enough that sometimes at home I can have them at home, and there have been times where I've been able to spend the whole day with them at home at the little dam that we have on our boundary. And they're not the same dogs. In fact, this last time I was at home, there was a pack. There were a pack of dogs, or there was a pack of dogs that was there that were 32 strong. They're known as the Auckland pack, so they're mostly Kruger dogs that had come into the Timbavati. And while friends of mine who came visiting saw them, I didn't get to see them at all. So, gosh, oh, hey Andrew, Hyena Road, notorious for mud wallows and bumps and sudden holes. Oh, golly gosh, how beautiful is this? I so needed an elephant fix because I had to drive past Ellie today. We were looking for the dogs. Now, I don't feel too bad. I know we didn't find them, and it's not going to be every time that we go out looking we're going to find them. The fact is that they have been around, so we had a greater chance of finding them today rather than any other day when they're not around and they haven't been seen in a while. Then our chances are like 2%. Today our chances were like as high as 90% because they were around. But being a rather hot day, they were no doubt lying up in the shade somewhere for the day, clearly far from any of the roads. It doesn't look like they moved far from the last place they had been seen this morning, which was further to the east of us. And so what we can count on is they're moving this evening and doing something at least so that we can find their tracks in the morning. Really beautiful sunset, he says in the same breath, changing subject without pausing. But Africa, from one thing to another, sometimes it's slow and sometimes there's just so much happening. I love it. It is who I am, it is what we do. And as it has always been, it is in our nature. Yes, no? Some of the cats have been to drink, I believe, from what I've just heard on the radio. Some of them have been down to the water to drink already, and it seems that when we came past the dam earlier to look for the deli. Down here, so we're seeing a little bit of sunset before it's really sunset. None of the cats here at the moment, but look at that beautiful sun reaching through the trees. Which station was Ngala? All on top end of the dam now. They're probably going to sleep in big jackalberries and things at the top end. Pretty close to our camp, actually. I guess we're going to have to close kitchens and rooms and things tomorrow morning. But they're definitely going to be sleeping here. It's far too late for them to get anywhere back to their normal sleeping trees. Sorry, Andrew. But it's time for cats to wake up and time for us to be with them. Interesting that we got the trooper baboon back today. Hang on, hand. Which station was Ngala? And I can see them there just going to approach. Hello. Hi everyone. Hi Andrew. Good and you? It's okay. Do you mind if I join you? Those other two haven't come down here. Gonna move back a little because we're in the way of them for the big male. I also don't really want to stand in the way, sort of between the dam. So it's try this. Time for cats to wake up, and it's time for some little action. I think they might still be a little bit full to be sort of interested in hunting. Now, having said that, if the opportunity arose, there's no doubt that they would actually try and do something. If they had a good chance of killing something, I think they would go for it. I think that buffalo is lucky that he left when he did.
got a pussycat. And a pussycat. You want to eat Andrew? I won't let you. You want to drink water?
Time for a drink. I think maybe somebody else might follow her.
Might be an idea for us to just go and watch her drink.
Two of them going to drink. Maybe the male will follow them too.
Sorry, I'm making a noise.
Digging for something. Let's follow those two. We'll watch them drink some water at the dam. That'd be a lovely sight to see. A lion sunset. Could be that having made that move, others might follow.
Like there are a couple more waking up. You see a male looking this way.
Hello, Deborah.
Deborah's asking, since we just drove through the area where there was elephant in must, would that scent stick to our clothing and be picked up by the lion?
I think what might happen is, you know, since during must an elephant dribbles from his penis, I think the most likely scenario would be that the smell of his urine dribbles would maybe adhere to the tires. But I don't think it would make any difference to them, quite honestly. I don't think it would have any bearing on them. Certainly not in the same way that if we happen to just inadvertently drive over some lion dung, and it would put the Land Rover in a bad light for some of the herbivores for a few days until we were rid of the smell. She's watching something. Looks like they split up a little bit. They might be watching something. It doesn't seem to be anything there. We came past. Don't know. Her posture is really low. Keeping an eye on something. Maybe it's the baboons in the background. She's reluctant to maybe be seen. A lioness is down here in the spillway, making her way to the water. Not really bothering about what might see her or what might not. She just wants to drink water.
In fact, the male's on his way also.
Male's also coming.
Yeah.
So we got to find ourselves a little spot. That's gonna. The baboons are starting to react. For her to go past, and then we'll try and go past her. Maybe we'll just try and come down. Oh, sorry, girl. Sorry. What that is behind her is the light for the camera when the camera's on.
I think what we'll do is we'll just stop down here. On the beach. Some of the young baboon that are starting to react to the presence of the lion. None of the adults are calling it. There's still just some words being shouted across the dam from the youngsters.
Don't go that way, girl. Find the trees in front of us, not behind us. Come this side. Come this side, please. Ooh, this way.
Well, I'll just go backwards. Let me go backwards a little bit. Space to drink. A lot of the pride coming down now to drink. This is one of the big females.
But she's coming right behind us.
Yeah. Hello, Kay. Kay's in Northridge wanting to know if we can get a strong smell of lion when they're not in a kill. Yes, sometimes, Kay. Today, with the heat and the wind, not easy to pick up the scent of lion, but sometimes, yes, it is possible. You can actually smell, especially when it's raining, you can smell their wet coats. They're a little hesitant to come down to the dam. I guess partly the baboon and partly a few other things. Sandy in Florida, would the lion hunt the baboons? Not really. They're too much energy. The baboons is going to go into trees. They're not gonna.
Okay, I'm going to try and get back a little bit more and hope this one's not going to jump off from this little tree onto you. It's only a youngster.
But they're a little bit nervous for whatever reason. Probably just because of the way they, I guess, crocodiles, hippos and things, they're coming to the water and sort of hissing. And a little bit apprehensive about coming down to the water, but they'll make it eventually. We're not in their way. I have seen lion hunt baboon, and it's been very unusual, or rather it's very, very seldom that it happens, but I have seen lion hunting baboon, and what it is they get them into a marula tree, where it's an isolated marula tree, and they intimidate them so much from the base of the tree that the baboon are forced to sort of take flying leaps out of the tree, and almost in cartoon fashion. Oh, there's a monitor lizard there. She just frightened a monitor lizard that is now swimming. Took off like a crocodile. Gave her a fright. It's almost like a cartoon where they're sort of running in midair so that by the time they hit the ground, their feet are already moving. And I actually have seen lion catching baboon in that matter, and leopard doing the same with vervet monkeys, but they're not a usual prey item. And let's face it, the troop of baboon are way over on the other side. By the time the lion get anywhere nearer to them, they'll be the top of trees. Lion are not great for hunting baboons in trees or anything, so. Yeah.
And it's just a natural reaction to snarl and sort of grimace at the water. It's just something that they're aware that there could be crocodiles. They're aware that, because there are dams in the area that obviously do, and hello, Bobby G. Bobby G's in Connecticut, wanting to know if that young male is an offspring of one of the Matimbas. I'm guessing probably he is, because he's tolerated by them. Whether he is or not, we would only be able to tell through genetic profiling. And here's this one with the big lump on her arm. I said goiter, not knowing that actually goiter refers to only something that happens in the throat. I thought anything with a lump was a goiter, but no, it's not, obviously, since I googled it. But yeah, she's got a big lump on her elbow, much like I've got a big lump on mine. I'll show you my lump on my elbow too one day. I don't know, it could be a number of things. I did get some information that it might be a result of TB. But anyways, it is easy enough to do some DNA profiling from the dung of individuals, and if you could see them defecating, you could maybe take a sample of dung and do a DNA profile if you had the sort of financial and scientific wherewithal to do that. But it would obviously would be very interesting to find out the genetic connection between them. And it would be interesting to know. I mean, can you imagine if you found out through genetic profiling that he actually isn't offspring of them, but they think he is, and that's why they tolerate him? That would be interesting. But for whatever reason, we can't really know these things. 246. We're missing a couple of cats. Hopefully they're going to come and join us. The light off to the left, by the way. I mean, we're sitting almost right in front of where the camera would be. If Juma Waterhole Cam was here, you'd be looking at their backs, because it's right behind them that the tree is. There's the tree now. There, right over there is the tree for the camera. That's the light that gives you good vision at night. And it'll be interesting to find out which way they're going to go after here, because it looks like this is it. They're going to be drinking. Whether they head back up to quarantine to go and catch another wildebeest or zebra or something. Three, four, five, six. Four cats missing. Hello, Ellen. Would a male lion prefer to mate with a younger female that hasn't mated before, or an older female? Actually, there isn't a preference, Ellen. It's got nothing to do with the preference of the older males, the big males. It's got to do with which lioness is in estrus and which lioness is ready to have cubs. And yes, sometimes you have young cubs, or rather sub-adult or young females that are coming into estrus for the first time. And they might be mated with the dominant male. The problem with that scenario is that he might even be her father. And what is likely to happen, because of the tenureship of a male over a territory, is that if he does hold the territory long enough, that he is going to mate with a young female, and that young female is likely to be his daughter, that those offspring are going to be highly vulnerable to predation by any other males coming in to the territory, because it is likely that the only reason why she managed to fall pregnant in the first place was because the resident male managed to hold on to his territory a little bit longer than expected. And so it stands to reason that if those offspring are killed, they would have been inbred offspring anyway. So if you had a group of females within a pride of different ages and they were all of childbearing age and new males came in, it wouldn't be a case of which one they would prefer to mate with as much as it would be a case of they would mate with the ones that are in estrus that needed to be mated with first. And I don't think, since it is driven by pheromones and hormones and things, I don't think that we would be able to draw an analogy with us human beings where some older men would prefer some younger models to some of the later models, if you don't mind me saying it that way. It seems I know so... No, I won't even go that far. Let's not talk about it. But it's all about raising cubs. It's all about passing on the genes. And it doesn't really matter how old the cats are. There's one of the rooms, the room number one actually, of Vuyatela. If you could imagine being a guest here at Vuyatela. Of course you'd be out on drive now, but sometimes it's nicer to just sit on your balcony or sit on your deck and watch life go by. And if you were sitting on that deck right now, you would see a pride of lion on the edge of the dam. Anything splashes in the water, they look at it and hiss at it. It could be terrapins or fish. Okay, is it safe enough for buffalo to get deep enough out of the way? Yeah, it is. I mean, if that buffalo was here, all he'd have to do was cross the dam and they'd have to go all the way around. They wouldn't follow him through the water. So it's, yeah, no, it wouldn't have to be deep enough. It wouldn't even have to be that deep at all. But it's difficult to predict something like that, okay? Because any number of things could happen. It's not an easy thing to try and speculate. Looks like they're heading back up to the lodge, which means they might be heading back up to quarantine. The baboons have all headed into the lodge. They all seem to be heading up to FC and the masts. I'm wondering if some of them aren't the old Gowrie gang that have joined up with a new gang and they just know where the sleeping trees are here. But time to follow them. Last few minutes of drive. Sorry, Andrew. Go. Yeah. A little bit of a start there. They're all heading up towards the lodge. Let's see if we can keep up with them. And what age the young females able to breed? I think Diane. There we go. Lion at the ground. Lion, baboon in the tree, lion on the ground. Exact circumstance I was talking about. If they intimidate those baboon enough, those baboon, well, they're going to likely climb as high into the tree as possible, which they are doing. The old camera tree, actually. This is the old camera tree. We used to have a camera on this tree. A couple of baboon up there. But I don't think they're going to bother, and I don't think the cats are going to bother much. From about 3 and a half, maybe 4 years old, I'd say, Diane. That'd also be nice to get out onto quarantine and see if we can find that other mating couple that might have come out into the open now. Well, she's doing it. She's intimidated these baboon enough that they're jumping into the apple leaf and they're actually going to try and gap it. Watch this, watch this, watch this. On the ground, and it's running away, and she's after it. And the other one's going to, the other one's going to, oh, there. You see, this is how a lion can single out. They have now singled out one baboon in this apple leaf. She chased it, it's a sub-adult too. She half-heartedly chased that one away. So now, this other one has come out of the tall tree into a low tree. I don't think he's going to be able to get back into the taller tree because it managed to jump from this knob thorn, or this black monkey thorn rather, into the apple leaf. Or is it a marula? It's a marula. I think she's just playing. She's just messing with him. But now she's lying under the tree and this baboon is going to go nuts because it's on its own now. It's a youngster. It's trying to climb as high up into those branches as it can. And trying to, shaking the tree, shaking branches, trying to intimidate the lioness as best it can. It better not climb onto a thin branch and fall because she will get it. It's normally not. There is a likelihood that the whole troop could gang up on them. If it wasn't so dark, we might even have that scenario where the troop is starting to come to the aid of this one that is caught, but it's a little bit too dark. Baboon are a little bit afraid of the dark. And they normally have to be in their sleeping trees by now. But, interesting scenario. She's watching it, the tail's switching. She's definitely psyching it out. Problem with baboon is that they can't sit still. And if it could, it would probably be safe. But it's probably getting more and more nervous now because it's getting dark, and I think it's going to be intimidated into spending the night in that tree on its own. The rest of the pride are all lying down, they're just sort of enjoying the evening, having just had their drink. Good night, Hardy Dawes. Hello, Sandra. Sandra's saying, can't blame the baboon for being afraid of the dark. She would too. Yeah, especially tonight, new moon. And it's going to be quite dark. It's lovely clear skies, but at least we're going to get starlight. And there's not going to be a moon. Tomorrow, maybe we'll be lucky enough to see the first crescent of the new moon.
Here comes the big male. Let's just watch. I'm going to turn a little bit so that we can see him arriving too. He's about to come onto the scene. I don't know if we'll miss anything here, I don't think so. But we can't miss this. Come along, Mr. Lion. He definitely didn't have any of that wildebeest yesterday. Sure he wouldn't mind a piece of baboon if he could get one, but I think he'd rather have some more buffalo. This is a magnificent lion. Not a youngster. He's like the equivalent of that big Ellie that we saw. He's a man in his prime, and he's seen a few things, and he's a lion. Hello, Chris. Will the baboon stay awake all night in fear? Will the lion get bored and move on? There's only one way to answer that, Chris, and that would be to be here all night to see. My guess is that yes, it's possible that the baboon are going to be nervous until they see the back of these lion, and although it's only going to be starlight, I'm sure they're going to be able to tell when the lion have moved on. And yes, I think to a large extent the lion are likely to just move on eventually anyway. Got better things to do than torment baboon. Okay, well now that he's sleeping, I want to go back to the scenario because get him. I mean, he is magnificent, isn't he? He is really a wonderful lion. But it's really hard, Chris, to tell what they're going to do. I mean, these are thinking beings. They have their own minds what they want to do. I see that lioness has already moved on, the one that was underneath the tree just while we were turned around. They're all sort of facing. Some of them are flat again, some of them are sleeping again, like the big male. Let's just take a big loop around this tree. I don't want to go so close, because if I do get too close to the tree, that baboon might get spooked by my presence, let alone the lion presence. Let's bring ourselves around here, and maybe we can see from a different angle. Without that lovely sunset glow, but we're just going to have more light behind us, might give us a better view of things. Back down to the rest of the crowd. Maybe she got bored.
Adam wants to know if there's a reason for the tuft of hair in the back of the forelegs. Gee, Adam, never thought about that. Jaws flying already. We don't need the light just yet. Maybe not. Hello, Linda. Glad to hear that Dallas is hot and hot again. Linda's in Dallas. If wanting to know if there is some notification going out to the guests. No, not here, Linda. I know that there are lodges in other parts of Africa where you can get a notification. They'll phone you 2 o'clock in the morning. They're lying at the dam or something. That doesn't happen here. At the moment, all the guests are out. When there are guests here at the moment, this time of day, they're all out on drive. And they're going to know about the lion being here anyway because, well, everybody knows that the lion are here. So it doesn't need, they don't really need to send a notification. But maybe you're referring to times when there are no drives. But no, it doesn't happen here. I don't think there's anyone that monitors the camera or the feed or anything. I guess it's something that they could implement, something I could talk to Candace about, that if somebody was monitoring the camera, that if they had guests here in the afternoon. The thing is, with these rooms, all these rooms face the dam, so if you're in your room, you're going to see what's there, and if you're not on your room and you're in the lodge, then, or rather, if you're not in your room and you're on drive, then you'll know about it because your guide will tell you. Because you'll go out and see it on the game drive. But I know there are some places in Africa, some very fancy lodges, where you can request, almost like you can request from the concierge or from the reception, you can request a wake-up call. If you want to leave early in the morning from a hotel here, in some lodges you can request to be told. I think it's up in Kenya. You can request information about what might be around. Okay, so a lot of these cats are just grooming and things. Maybe we need to. Oh, maybe it. Do you think a baboon's still in the tree?
I don't think so.
I wonder if maybe it didn't jump out and she chased it and that's why she's not here anymore. This is the old water hole. We're going into the bottom. This is the old Juma water hole that we're going into now. Used to be a water, all these rocks on the edges. And this is where elephant used to come and play and lion used to drink. I think when we were turned around looking at that male, I think something happened. That youngster managed to escape, or the lioness got bored. She got enough light. Looks like it. Right. So in some ways, very much like last night when we left these cats, not knowing what we're going to find in the morning, we're in the same situation again today. Don't know what's going to transpire during the night. If they go back up to quarantine, they're going to find themselves another animal, or they can, that's for sure. Whether they do or not is another matter. But we will only know in the morning. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, I think there's 7 here.
There's cool. But one that might have been. Yeah, I think when we turned around to watch that big male coming down the road, I think that's when that things changed for that little baboon and it managed to get out of the tree. We certainly would have heard it if the lion caught it, that's for sure. And we would have had a pandemonium breaking out here. Not only with the baboons, but with the lion all piling in, wanting to get their own little bite. Quarantine on the way back, pick up Brian. We're just going to go see if we can see the other two mating pair, maybe just to get an idea of where they are to start with in the morning. Generally, when they're mating, they don't move very far, so there's a good chance that having had that kill, they might still be here for a while. We will go and have a look at that. And other than that, well, we're gonna be looking at lion tracks tomorrow morning. There are certainly a lot of lion tracks on Vuyatela Access Road, and hopefully we'll be able to see which ones are fresh if they go back up that way. But it's all gonna wait till tomorrow, so you're all gonna have to wait till tomorrow. And from me, Mark, and Andrew back behind the camera, Brian in final control, all of us here at Wild Earth, thank you for joining me. Thank you for the questions. I'm sorry if I didn't get to some of them. Or if I didn't get to them correctly, tomorrow's another day. Love you lots. Take care. Goodbye. And hope you've enjoyed your day with us here at Wild Earth and Juma Game Reserve. Look at that. They're playing. Do we have to go now? I can smell.
It's a big man.